Let's look at the scrotal sac. The scrotal sac is also referred to as the scrotum, and it is a bag that houses the testes. Let's go through with this lecture to enjoy the anatomy of the scrotum. The scrotum is a fibromuscular cutaneous pouch, which means that it is made up of fibrous tissue. It is made up of muscular tissue and also cutaneous tissue. And this is the scrotal sac. And within this sac is where we have the location of the testes. This is like a dual chambered sac that houses the testes. Because the testes are paired structure, the scrotum also tends to take the configuration of the testes, thereby creating a two-chambered structure to house the testes. So this is where we have the scrotum, and inside the scrotum is where we have the testes. And this is the testes. Location of the scrotum. Where is the scrotum located? Because we said that the scrotum houses the testes, and we know that the testes is located behind the penis. This is the rectum, and this is the anus that opens out of the rectum. Between the anus posteriorly and the penis anteriorly, we have the scrotum. And within the scrotum, we have the testes. So this is the location of the scrotum, located between the penis and the anus. And this is the scrotum. Functions of the scrotum. We know that the scrotum houses the testes. That is, its primary function is to create accommodation site for the testes. And the second function is that it helps to regulate temperature. Because we say that the process of spermatogenesis needs to occur at a temperature that is lower than that of the body. And we know that the testes is located inside the scrotum. And for spermatogenesis to occur, which is the reason behind the existence of the testes, is to produce spermatozoa. The temperature needs to be regulated. And the scrotum helps in this regard because it helps to either pull the testes towards the body or take it away from the body, depending on the situation at hand. If the temperature is high, it means that the temperature of the body will also be high. And for it to attain a cooler temperature, it will need to pull it away from the body. And by so doing, it helps to regulate the temperature of the testes. And the scrotum is able to do this because it has gadgets that helps to either pull it towards the body or take it away from the body. So as we go with this lecture, we see that the scrotum is made up of muscle that helps in this regard. The contents of the scrotum. The structures that are seen within the scrotum include primarily the testes. We already know that it is a structure that creates accommodation for the testes. And this is the testes. Then the next structure we have is the epididymis. The epididymis is a highly coiled tube that is seen on the posterior lateral part of the testes. This is the testes. And after the testes, we have the emergence of the epididymis. And this is the epididymis. The epididymis is also part of the content that is seen within the scrotum. Then the next structure is the spermatic cord. The spermatic cord will be the initial segment of the spermatic cord. We know that the spermatic cord is a collection of structures that run to and through the testes. The blood vessels that supply the testes also run through. As a component of the spermatic cord, we have the innervations. We have the nerves that innervate the testes. Then we have the vas deferens. The vas deferens is a tubular extension of the epididymis. This is the epididymis, and this is the vas deferens highlighted in green. And this also forms part of the component of the spermatic cord as they run upward. We also have the spermatic fascia. The spermatic fascia are fascia that extend from the abdominal cavity. We also see this as we go through with this lecture. So the fascia extends and are wrapped around the testes. So all these structures, the fascia, the vas deferens, and also vessels and nerves collectively form the spermatic cord, and this is the region where they are. But the initial segment of the spermatic cord is what is seen within the scrotum. Then the next structures are two muscles. These muscles are seen lining the walls of the scrotum. We see where these muscles are specifically located during the course of this lecture. So we have two muscles. We have the datus muscle and we have the cremasteric muscle. So this is the cremasteric muscle and this is the datus muscle. So this muscle also forms part of the structural component of the scrotum. Talking about the scrotum in regulating the temperature of the testes, there's a relationship between the body and the scrotum in response to heat. During cold weather, this is the body and this is the scrotal region. The temperature of the body would definitely be higher than what is seen in the scrotal region. And in order to enjoy the heat from the body, the scrotum will be pulled towards the body so as to enjoy warmness. By doing this, it's helping to regulate the temperature of the testes. So in the quest of enjoying warmth, it tends to shrink. By allowing the cremasteric muscle that is seen in the wall of the scrotum to contract. And when it contracts, it tends to pull the scrotum towards the body so as to enjoy the warmness of the body during cold weather. And if it's the other way around, when the weather is hot, it means that the temperature of the body will be higher than what is seen in the scrotal region. And for the scrotum to protect the testes, by not allowing too much of the heat to reach it, there's going to be the loosening of the cremasteric muscle. This muscle tends to relax, thereby pulling the testes away from the body so that the heat that is coming from the body will be dispersed and a very little quantity will be able to reach the scrotum. And this will help to control the temperature of the testes. So this is how the scrotum tends to move up towards the body and also down away from the body, depending on the temperature. And in doing this, it's helping to control the temperature of the testes that will allow optimal temperature for spermatogenesis to occur. So let's go to the layers of the scrotum. The wall of the scrotum is made up of layers, the fibromuscular cutaneous tissue. By the time we highlight the different layers of the scrotum, we'll see that it is made up of fascia, it is made up of muscle, and it is made up of cutaneous tissue. So let's go through this. Looking at the tunica albugina, we already talked about the tunica albugina. This is the tunica albugina, the region highlighted in black. This forms part of the structural component of the testes because it actually covers directly the testes and also drive in into the tissue of the testes, dividing it into lobes. So this may not be highlighted as part of the layers of the scrotum because it forms part of the structural component of the testes. So you can go and check up our lecture on the testes as we have described what the tunica albugina is to upgrade your knowledge in this area. So the first layer we'll be talking about is the tunica vaginalis. This is the tunica vaginalis highlighted in red. This is the layer that overlies the tunica albugina. We have the third layer, the spermatic fascia. The spermatic fascia is subdivided into three subdivisions. We have the internal spermatic fascia. This is the internal spermatic fascia. We have the cremasteric fascia. This is the cremasteric fascia. Then we have the external spermatic fascia highlighted in green. So these are the three subdivisions of the spermatic fascia. Next layer is the superficial fascia. This is the superficial fascia. And after which then we have the skin. And this is the skin. So this is how the wall of the scrotum is molded to perfectly be able to house the testes. So we'll take the layers one after the other to see what they are structurally made up of. For the first layer, the tunica vaginalis. The tunica vaginalis, we say that is a region that overlies the tunica albugina. This is the tunica albugina highlighted in black. The tunica vaginalis are divided into two sublayers. We have the visceral layer. This is the visceral layer. The visceral layer is the layer that forms contact with the tunica albugina. Then we have the parietal layer. Between the visceral layer and the parietal layer, there is a space created between these two subdivisions. And this space is called the cavity of the tunica vaginalis. The cavity that is formed by the visceral and the parietal layer of the tunica vaginalis may also be referred to as the cavum vaginalis, cavum from cavity. Within this space, we have viscous fluid that helps to lubricate the surface of the testes. So the two testes are able to move freely against each other, thereby reducing the friction between them. This is allowed by this viscous fluid that is contained within the two layers of the tunica vaginalis. So this is the tunica vaginalis. It is a closed sac extending through the anterior part of the scrotum, the medial part of the scrotum, and also the lateral part of the scrotum. So you see it in the anterior part, the medial part, and the lateral part. In the posterior part, it is deficient. It's not seen in the posterior part. It tends to like create space for the epididymis. This is the epididymis. So it tends to create space for the epididymis at this region, so it does not run through this space. Then the next layer of the scrotum is the spermatic fascia. This fascia encircles the testes, thereby creating or forming part of the structural component of the wall of the scrotum. And where they extend from is an extension from the abdominal muscle. In the abdomen, we have the transversalis muscle, we have the internal oblique, and we have the external oblique. These three layers of muscle are found in the abdominal space. The fascia extending from these muscles descend down and they are wrapped around the testes, thereby forming part of the wall of the scrotum. So this is the way they go. Fascia from each of these three muscles will now form the three fascia that make up the spermatic fascia. So this spermatic fascia is further subdivided into three, and it's as a result of the continuation from the three individual abdominal muscles. So let's see how they run. The first one is the internal spermatic fascia. The internal spermatic fascia is a continuation of the fascia of the transversalis muscle from the abdomen. So this is the abdominal region, and this is the fascia that extends from the transversalis muscle in the abdomen, and it descends down. When it gets down, it wraps around the testes, and of course, it overlies the tunica vaginalis. This tunica vaginalis highlighted in red, and overlining it is the internal spermatic fascia that is highlighted in black. So this is the internal spermatic fascia, and you see it running through, covering the entire surface of the testis, thereby forming the wall of the scrotum. Then the next layer is a continuation of the internal oblique. If you trace it down, this is the internal oblique muscle, and the fascia, of course, descends down and wrapping over the internal spermatic fascia. This is the internal spermatic fascia highlighted in black. So this is the fascia of the internal oblique muscle. But this fascia is specifically referred to as the cremasteric fascia in the scrotum. Why is it referred to as a cremasteric fascia? Because it contains fibers of the cremasteric muscle. So let's trace it from up here. This is the internal oblique muscle, and this is the fascia of the internal oblique muscle descending down. When it gets here, it wraps around the testes, thereby forming part of the coat that surrounds it. And descending down, this fascia is now termed the cremasteric fascia. The cremasteric muscle is responsible for controlling the movement of the scrotum towards the body and also away from the body. When this muscle contracts, it tends to pull the scrotum towards the body, and when it relaxes, it takes the scrotum away from the body. So this is the cremasteric fascia, and lying on the cremasteric fascia, we have the cremasteric muscle. The cremasteric muscle also extends up into the inguinal canal. Then the third layer is the external spermatic fascia, and this one runs from the external oblique muscle in the abdomen. This is the external oblique muscle. They run and they also descend down. When they get around the scrotal region, they wrap around the scrotum, and they are referred to as the external spermatic fascia. And this is the external spermatic fascia highlighted in green. So you can see how fascia from the abdominal muscle run down, and they become part of the coat that surrounds the testes. These three fascia are called the spermatic fascia, and of course, they originate from muscles in the abdomen. The next layer is the superficial fascia. Just as we have in other regions of the body, we have the superficial fascia underlining the skin. And also the superficial fascia also extends from the abdominal region. This is the superficial fascia in the abdominal region. In the abdominal region, you see them lined with fatty tissue. So this is the fatty tissue seen in dotted line in the abdominal space. And when they descend down to the scrotum, this fat deposition is replaced by muscle that's called the ductus muscle. So you see the superficial fascia in this region, and the fatty tissue is then replaced with ductus muscle in the scrotal region. And it is this ductus muscle that is responsible for the wrinkling action of the scrotum during the process of controlling or regulating it. The ductus muscle helps to control or reduce the rate at which it is being lost. When it contracts, it tends to form a wrinkling effect. And this wrinkling effect, we tend to reduce the surface area for loss of it. So when it wrinkles, it tends to reduce the rate at which it is being lost. It is this datus muscle that helps in the wrinkling action of the surface of the scrotum, thereby helping to control the rate at which it is lost through surface area reduction. The superficial fascia in this region may also be referred to as the datus fascia, because it is on the superficial fascia that we have the fibers of the datus muscle. Then the last region is the skin, which is the most external part of the scrotum. This skin is thin, is wrinkled, and also pigmented. This wrinkledness is as a result of the datus muscle that helps to contract during temperature regulation. Another structure that is seen as it relates to the skin is the median raphae. The median raphae is a longitudinal ridge that is seen along the surface of the scrotum. And this ridge is as a result of the embryonic fusion of the two lateral labioscrotal swelling during the development of form. So this tends to form a ridge. And of course, this shows a kind of demarcation for the testes, and also is able to align and give a surface demarcation also to the scrotum in helping to house the testes. Blood supply and innervation. The blood supply and innervation of the scrotum is different from that of the testes. We know that in the testes, their blood supply and innervation come from the abdomen, and that is as a result of the developmental process. For the scrotum, they take their blood supply and innervation from the structures located around them. The blood supply of the scrotum is by three vessels. The first one is the anterior scrotal artery. This is the anterior scrotal artery. We have the common iliac artery dividing into the external iliac artery and the internal iliac artery. From the external iliac artery, we have the femoral artery. And the femoral artery gives off the external pudendal artery, where the anterior scrotal artery emerges from to supply the anterior region of the scrotum. Then we have the cremasteric artery, and this is the cremasteric artery. The cremasteric artery emerges from the inferior epigastric artery. This is the common iliac artery. This is the external iliac artery. From the external iliac artery, we have the inferior epigastric artery. It is from the inferior epigastric artery that we have the emergence of the cremasteric artery that supplies the cremasteric muscle and also the skin of the scrotum. The last arterial supplies from the posterior scrotal artery. This is the posterior scrotal artery, and this emerges from the internal pudendal artery. Internal pudendal artery is a branch of the internal iliac artery. So that is how we have the supply of the scrotum. Then the venous drainage is drained into the scrotal vein, which finally empties into the external pudendal vein. We have innervation. The innervation of the scrotum is extensive. The anterior and lateral aspect of the scrotum is innervated by the anterior scrotal nerves, and this emerges from genital branches of the genitofemoral nerve and also ilioinguinal nerve. So this supplies the anterior region and the lateral region of the scrotum. Posteriorly, we have the posterior scrotal nerve. This is the posterior scrotal nerve. And the posterior scrotal nerve is derived or emerges from perineal branches of the pudendal nerve. So this tends to supply the posterior region of the scrotum. The lymphatics is drained into nearby lymph nodes, into the superficial inguinal lymph node. Looking at the clinical anatomy that I want to highlight is the hematoma of the scrotum. This occurs as a result of swelling and discoloration of the scrotal skin. This may occur from scrotal surgery or may occur as a result of trauma around the genital region. This condition is resolved on its own, and there are times where we need to take anti-inflammatory medication. We can check our understanding of this lecture through the following questions. And the first one is to describe the layers of the scrotum. These we have highlighted during the course of this lecture. Also, I liked the content of the scrotum. And the third question, is the blood supply of the scrotum the same as that of the testes that it houses? If yes, please provide your answer. And if no, please state why. Thanks for watching this video.